Ông quên chỗ. Ông nhận ra cam to cái tâm nạc ca tệ thị tâm nạc ca. Tâm nạc ca này ông nhận ra thư tâm nạc ca một tổ sắp đập cam dây nạy chùm nến Hinton. Làm chi tâm nạc ca, tôi sẽ cầu vật thí là đi cam vì thà nạc hiệu vật tâm miến, ạ vật tâm miến, phía ký nâng bọc cùl để ông nhận ra có hẳn chưa nhờ cho rùm được nông cái tâm nạc ca, tâm nạc ca thay này.
សូមគោរពលោកប្រធានសម្រាប់សកម្មភាពនៅថ្ងៃនេះក្លាមជីក៏សម្គាល់ឃើញថាគ្រប់ភាគីទាំងអស់នៃរឿងក្តីនេះមានវត្តមានដោយឡែកលោកនួនជាមានវត្តមាននៅបន្ទប់ខំខ្លួនខាងក្រោមសាលសកម្មភាពនេះដោយលោកស្នាសុំលះបងសិទ្ធមានវត្តមានដោយផ្ទាល់ពីបន្ទប់សកម្មភាពនៅថ្ងៃនេះលិខិតលះបងសិទ្ធរបស់លោកនួនជាបានប្រកល់ដល់ក្លាមជីរួចហើយអ្នកជំនាញដែលត្រូវមកផ្ដល់សេចក្តីកម្មបន្តនៅថ្ងៃនេះគឺលោកហ៊ីនតុនលោកមានវត្
ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាជាមុនសិនអង្គជំរះបានទទួលលិខិតសំលះបងសិទ្ធចូលរួមសកម្មការដែលផ្ទាល់ក្នុងបន្ទប់សកម្មការនេះរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាចោតថ្ងៃទី15ខែមីនាឆ្នាំ2026ដែលបានបញ្ជាក់ថាដែលគាត់មានបញ្ហាសុខភាពឈឺក្បាលឈឺចង្កេះមិនអាចអង្គុយយូរបានមិនអាចចង់អារម្មណ៍បានយូរនិងមានលទ្ធភាពចូលរួមសកម្មការនីយថ្ងៃខាងមុខឲ្យមានប្រសិទ្ធភាពរួមសំលះបងសិទ្ធចូលរួមនិងមានវត្តមានដែលផ្ទាល់នៅក្នុងបន្ទប់សកម្មការន ពីនិតភៀបាលថែទាំសុខភាពជនយកចោលនៅអវតកចោះថ្ងៃទី15ខែមីនាឆ្នាំ2006បានគាត់សម្គាល់ពីស្ថានភាពសុខភាពរបស់លោកនួនជានៅថ្ងៃនេះថាមានអាការៈឈឺចង្កេះខ្លាំងពេលអង្គុយយូរនិងពេលធ្វើចលនានិងបានផ្ដល់អនុសាសន៍ថាសូមឲ្យជំរះអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យលោកនួនជាចូលរួមតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្រាប់ការពីបន្ទប់មួយស្ថិតនៅក្រោមសាសនាការនេះ ไปเรื่องมูลฐานนี้หนึ่งโยงตามบรรยัติในบทเทียนไปถึงมวยปรามในบทเทียนไตรขนงอวตกองดิมได้อนุญาตเอาจุนจบยอดนุนชี้โจร่วมในตามนั้นกิจกรรมการสัมมนาประจำง่ายปีบรรทุกคุมครูนมวยทัดในกรามซาสัมมนาอิสตามระยะประกอบสอดตัวสำหรับจะเปิลสัมมนาเป็นมวยไงนี่ประกอบใบบกเล็กในสอดตัวจวบประปอนสอดตัวสำหรับเป็นจบยอดนุนชี้อาจโจร่วมในตามนั้นกิจกรรมการสัมมนาประจำง่ายขนงอมลองเปิลในกิจกรรมการสัมมนาสำหรับไงนี่
Good morning, Mr. President. Good morning, Your Honours.
Chim Lipsu, Lokutin, Lokosicham, Krom, Sakari, Chim Lipsu, Lok Sastracha.
Professor, yesterday,
Lok Sastracha, Kapi, Masalming Yung.
បានយាយគ្នាអំពីមូលហេតុមួយចំនួនដែលនាំឲ្យមានការសម្លាប់ក្នុងទ្រង់ទ្រៃធំក្នុងរបបកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យដែលការរស់នៅក្នុងមូលដ្ឋានក៏ដូចជាសកលថ្ងៃនេះខ្ញុំសូមចូលទៅដល់ផ្នែកទី3
ជាពិសេសគឺការប្រព្រឹត្តមកលើជនជាតិវៀតណាមនៅក្នុងរបបកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យតាមការយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ្ញុំតាមការយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ្ញុំតាមការយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ្ញុំតាមការយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ្ញុំតាមការយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ្ញុំតាមការយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ្ញុំតាមការយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ្ញុំតាមការយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ្ញុំតាមការយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ្ញុំតាមការយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ្ញុំតាមការយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ្ញុំតាមការយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ្ញុំតាមការយល់ឃើញរបស់ខ Việt Nam trong bàn kề chặt tục thà đội mà đánh đá nó không nông bật tế Campuchia nó không nông ông lòng bề ở sông kriếm luôn.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Co-Prosecutor. So in terms of the historical relationship, again, views, distinctions between us and them, between, for example, the Khmer ethnic group and the Vietnamese ethnic group, it changes through time depending on the historical context. But you can find long-standing strands of anti-Vietnamese sentiment to go back in time. It's linked to a historical situation where different periods in history, for example, The Vietnam came in, took Cambodian territory,
the
danger of Cambodia disappearing,
the French came in.
You know, there are legends such as the legend of the Master's Tea that's cited in the Black Pepper,
Black Pepper book,
that sort of condenses part of the fear of the Vietnamese and also anger and vitriol towards Vietnamese. But that very much people were buried. Anyways, they boil tea on top of the heads of Khmer, but that very much sort of symbolically condenses the notion of threat, the perceived threat against the Vietnamese. So you have this strand that goes far back and worked into the future, into the present during the Long Nol regime. You know, I don't have the demographic analysis. I believe it's 400,000. Ethnic Vietnamese are thought to have been in Cambodia in 1970. Under the Khmer Republic,
thank you, Professor. If I can just stop you there. Just before we move to the period of civil war,
the
perception and treatment of Vietnamese in Cambodia there, you talked about the contrast between historically how Vietnamese were viewed,
contrast
to Khmer or other Cambodians. Can you tell us how ethnic Khmer were viewed historically?
Referring
back to the ideas in your book, page
215, you talk about
the anchor civilization and the decline of Angkor, and how that related to the characters of Khmer were perceived,
in
contrast to how Vietnamese were perceived. And if I can ask you to speak a little more slowly.
Vietnam vinh yul khơn giang đôi mặt đài.
Lúc nãy chấm đinh cũng an toàn xoay tóp, thông tin lúc mình bị bệnh tật cổ phế.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, Your
Honour.
I have an objection, which is at the same time an observation. The previous question, but also now, Vietnamese people living in Cambodia.
Look, John, some loud to learn Jun Jet, Vietnam, Rukunong, Pate, Campuchia, Pichet, Subject Pram, Jet Pram, Jet Rumbun,
citizens in North and South Vietnam, and later.
Got looks some loud to learn, Pichu Vietnam,
or does he refer Vietnam to Jung, Vietnam, Vietnam, Vietnam as a country with its foreign policy?
Got looks some loud to learn, Vietnam, Tiamul Tamadong,
DK. Toward Laos,
toward other countries.
One of the big problems, I believe, is that there is a continuous mixing up of Vietnamese citizens and Vietnamese foreign policy.
Thank you,
Your Honor. I will direct the expert to the Vietnamese generally, the Vietnamese race generally. Obviously, we don't want to have unclear testimony, but the defense can cross-examine. And also, Your Honour's quite lengthy objections. It really does need to be interrupted some time. I think we've mentioned that quite briefly. It does add up. But I understand the general point. To create some extra clarity,
I'm going to ask you to ask me to ask you 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 to ask ហើយប្រមិនមានបញ្ហាណាខុសឆ្គងឬក៏មានការមិនពេញលិញដែលលោកចង់សួរបញ្ជាក់រងចាំដល់ពេលឱកាសដែលអង្គជំរះផ្ដល់ឱកាសទៅមេធាវីដែលនឹងតាំងសំណួរចុងក្រោយក្រោយភាគីម្ខាងទៀតអញ្ចឹងហើយបានជាអង្គជំរះបានប៉ះនីតិវិធីតុលាការផ្ដល់ចិត្តការពារខ្លួននៅក្រោយពេលខាងចោតប្រកាន់នឹងតាំងសំណួរដេញដោលមុនអ្វីៗទាំងអស់គឺទុកការពារខាងក្រោយដើម្បីស្ដាប់ដើម្បី
understood
all of that. How were the Vietnamese generally as a race viewed?
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Co-Prosecutor. Interesting and important questions have been raised.
The use
of the word race
in
general, in the UN Genocide Convention, it's a somewhat problematic category.
Sometimes
the word in Khmer is used. Anyways, maybe that's a different issue, but I think more broadly it opens up questions of what is a national group, which again is something that deserves due consideration as another category within the UN Genocide Convention. I can put that aside, but I think it's important to take up again. In terms of your specific question, when the French came in on Korean civilization, had largely been forgotten and was reconstructed by French archaeologists, ethnographers, and others, and it became tied up to a sense of Khmer nationalism, the construction of an ancient past, a civilization that went through decline, and this has become a motif historically of sort of the attempt to rise back up to achieve and aspire for the greatness of the Angkorian period. Within this, one strand, so that again begins to build the Khmer nationalist theme of some notion of there being an essential pure Khmer goodness to which others are opposed. If we go back to the notion of the crystallization of difference again, people are aware of differences between self and other, between different groups, and they become, these differences become accentuated at different moments in time. I guess you don't want to move into the Khmer Republic regime, but suffice it to say that within this category of Khmer purity, the purity of my group, other groups were opposed, especially the Vietnamese, on this ethnic boundary, ethnic distinction, and is illustrated by the story of Master's Tea that's in the black paper. There's the notion of stereotypes of the Vietnamese as thieving, covetous Khmer territory, people who use trickery, people who are bad, and of course there's the term that's frequently invoked, which is the term Nguyen, which is used, and also sometimes is used by people in colloquial speech, but often is used and almost somewhat spat out as the only way to say it, with emotion, the hatred of, quote-unquote, the Nguyen, and that term itself is one that signals this hatred of the Vietnamese other.
So, perhaps to conclude, historically, prior to 1970, Cambodian governments historically have viewed Vietnamese as an ethnic group or as a race or Vietnamese generally in a demeaning way.
Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. With the caveat that, again, historically through time, this notion is mobilized in different ways to fit the historical situation.
Thank you.
And if we can briefly deal with the Khmer Republic period, the Lon Nol period, the Civil War between 1970 and 1975, if you can briefly give a summary of how the Lon Nol government and treated
Again, with this mobilization at this point in time under the Khmer Republic, Buddhism was a very key context, in other words, they were non-believers. But again, you've got the rhetoric of the evil outside invader, someone who is subverting the country. It was very vehement rhetoric. And again, in terms of the demographics, I believe, I don't have the demographic report in front of me, something estimated maybe there were 400,000 ethnic Vietnamese in Cambodia, and perhaps half of them were expelled or killed. I think it would be quite possible that you could argue that genocide was committed against them even during the Khmer Republic era.
And
in your book, page 217, you refer to And perhaps just to finish in relation to how the Lon Nol government and the forces that sentiment was communicated by the government, apart from through
military
action, but through
propaganda. I wouldn't want to, without doing further research, to specify that, because it's an area that's somewhat underexplored. But I do know from talking to people from existing secondary sources, but beyond sort of propaganda broadcast calls, what's been written is that it's pretty clear that it was omnipresent, but I wouldn't want to give an opinion on that.
Perhaps then if we can switch to the view you put forward, and this is at page 218 of your book.
So again, it's I'm sure we'll get into more detail about it. The demographic data is very revealing in this regard. After an initial period of expulsions that took part, that took place immediately after. The beginning of DK, people aren't sure, maybe 200,000 ethnic Vietnamese or so roughly left in Cambodia, maybe 150,000 or more left the country, were expelled, some are thought to have been killed. But by and large, with the demographic estimates, it was thought that perhaps there were, in the end, after this period of expulsions, 20,000 ethnic Vietnamese left in the country, and by the end of DK, virtually all of them are thought to have been killed.
Thank you. Perhaps if I can stop you there, and I'd like to read to you a short passage At tab 7.1 in your folder, there's an excerpt from the April 1976 revolutionary flag. That's E3/759, English 0051, English 7.5.5.5.4, and Khmer 0.06.2749, French 0.049.9717, and it's tab 7.1, and it's from the revolutionary flag, and I'll read it. However, a revolution, in particular on the 17th of April 1975, sorted this issue out cleanly and sorted it out entirely. We assume that we sorted it out permanently. For thousands of years, we were unable to resolve this issue and did not resolve it. Exploiting classes did not only not sort this out, they sold whole sections of land to these foreigners. Now, we have sorted out this issue. Our revolutionary workers, our revolutionary peasants, our people, our revolutionary army sorted this out completely and permanently. The dimensions of this victory are huge, very profound, very magnificent. Sorting this out was not easy, however, it was done by going along with the imperialists and by following proper methods, following our revolutionary principles. That is, the Great Typhoon is a national movement, and the Great Typhoon is a democratic revolution. Swept hundreds of thousands of these foreigners clean and expelled them from our country, brought them permanently out of our territory. This is the great pride and full satisfaction of our entire people, our entire army, and our entire party. In light of what you said in relation to the expulsion of the Vietnamese at the beginning of the Democratic Campuchia period, in light of this statement in the revolutionary flag, are you able to give an opinion on who is being referred to? In the States, we've swept hundreds of thousands of these foreigners clean and expelled them out of our country.
Our revolutionary flag is being referred to as the Great Typhoon. Our revolutionary flag is being referred to as the Great Typhoon.
It would seem to refer to ethnic Vietnamese in Cambodia.
Vietnam rung rung bote Cambodia
hai.
Ban lok prathean sa prinya rong ot bak kabal micro ot lue te.
Okay. Prosecutor.
Do you have an opinion whether those hundreds of thousands of people expelled were in fact ethnic Vietnamese civilians living in Cambodia for 4 years beforehand, or were some of them who had been tricked and stayed on, and were given to understand that who they were was likely to be?
Was likely to be. Given the broader context to the supposition about it, it would seem to refer to ethnic Vietnamese who were living in Cambodia at the time the DK regime took power.
And what does that passage, in your opinion, tell you? Do you have an opinion on any effect that type of passage might have on CPK Carver reading it and teaching the contents of the revolutionary flag in relation to how the CPK leadership and Vietnamese civilians generally in Cambodia.
And again, what year was the
The revolutionary flag was April 1976.
Yeah, I think it's also important both with ethnic Vietnamese and ethnic Chinese, as I talked about with the notion of cumulative radicalization. There are also differences in the flow depending on the degree of threat that was felt by the DK regime. So in 1976, actually the rhetoric became much stronger as tensions and open conflict with Vietnam escalated in 1978. But I think it seems pretty clear that they're talking about purification again. The distinction between the Johns, as I said yesterday to me, is that they were not in the same way perceived as an immediate threat. We had this threat of long-standing animosity and vitriol towards ethnic Vietnamese in Cambodia that was mobilized almost from the start, certainly was there during the Lon Nol regime and continued with the DK regime, whereas with ethnic Johns, it seems to be that while people were aware of the difference, it began to crystallize after the rebellions. So again, I want to make the distinction between those two threads, and also note with cumulative radicalization that there is not always a plan to kill everybody right at the beginning from the start, but it's something that comes in based on historical factors like rebellions, like escalating war, if we talk about conflict with Vietnam.
Thank you, and I think some of the questions I will have to follow will start to address that escalation of tension or threat. You've told us yesterday that your book is maybe primarily made up of three types of sources. Academic sources on historical aspects of the Khmer-Rouge period. Some interviews that you conducted with people living in former cadre, civilians living, and also your study and review of the primary original documentation or some of it that was produced by the Communist Party of Cambodia through revolutionary flags and other documents. Is that correct? There are three types of sources, apart from perhaps your anthropological, ethnographic, and comparative background?
So the sources, again, that I drew upon, continue to draw upon, are the existing scholarship, work done by historians like David Chandler and Ben Kiernan, certainly, but I also have a great deal of primary data in relationship, for example, to Region 41 of the Central Zone, Kampong Siam District, I write about in my book, how in 1977, again, the Southwest Cadre came in.
Would it be fair to say that the main information that you produce in the book,
So, in terms in particular, I was concerned with tracing the network of Khoi Thuan, which reached when he...
Sorry, I don't want to stop you,
but perhaps
can you answer without going into the discussion of the reasons themselves?
So with regard to the central zone, region 41, I talked to Phil there on the ground and traced that out and then connected it to the work of senior scholars at the Chandler.
ទៀតហើយខ្ញុំបានតាមដានទៅលើរឿងរ៉ាវទាំងអស់នេះ
My first question is, In your book, English
0043-1596,
page 154, you state that Tia, a former cadre who worked at the sub-district office in Krala, Kampong Siam district, told you that the sub-district office received a letter, and that office from grandmother Hicks, district headquarters in mid-1977. Teep stated, quote, the letter instructed us to smash internal enemies, Cham, Vietnamese, capitalists, former Lon Nol workers, intellectuals and CIA agents. My first question is, do you know grandmother Yit's full name?
Thank you, Mr. President. I think we're moving into a peculiar situation because
we have two redacted and two unidentified parties,
which we should be able to verify. So,
before we ask any further questions, we should be able to verify.
I've only heard an observation or objection. If this is true, please move ahead.
Do you know grandmother Yit's full name?
Ta luk dang tha chmuh peing robos Yit Yit nang chmuh oi dae.
At the time everyone referred to her as Yit Yit. Grandmother Yit. So people did not refer to her full name, but it seems quite clear that
You're not in control of the button. But I'd like to talk about your conversation that you had with Tia, former Khmer cadre. Now, I think you stated he worked at the sub-district office in Krala, and that's how he became aware of this letter. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you That's correct. Under a relative of grandmother Yut's, whose name was Rong.
And did he have a copy of the letter when he spoke to you? Did he say that he knew where the copy of that letter or the original letter was when he spoke to you? Was there any discussion about what happened to the letter?
ដឹងទេថាលិខិតហ្នឹងគេបញ្ជូនទៅដល់ណាអីដល់ណីដែរ
No, there wasn't. I should just note that I'm doing research even at this time. I would say that whatever documents might have existed were deteriorated and written by insects. Over and over again, I heard that about the documentation.
So he said that the letter instructed us to smash the internal enemies, Chams, Vietnamese, capitalists,
Chao Vietnam mua lợi thương dùng và tay tạm cầm và tay tạm trái luôn nó và nhà chân nâng phần hệ sĩ ạ cho mình tất cả các mẹ phát đáp của mẹ bằng thay em tiết thật ta
cao chập khuôn
trong niềm mùi đồng mùi nâng kia bán kia thua lãng mẹn được tế kia thua lãng nâng không nâng đại được tế
Yes. But it was, especially with the Cham in this district, it does not appear to have been a large ethnic Vietnamese population. In my interviews with villagers, ethnic Vietnamese were saying, oh, there was maybe one in our village, and that person was taken away, versus the Cham families were in much larger numbers. So he did say that they were rounded up, sometimes told they were going to the rubber plantation.
Chúng ta vô tại đạn nơi chắc cả cái xu hay sầm lấp chào nơi kia nữa.
With the villagers extensively refers to the killing of Chams and sprinkled in there, they would say, oh, there was one Vietnamese family and two people. But again, nobody would say there were 50 Vietnamese, ethnic Vietnamese families. So the numbers of ethnic Vietnamese appeared to have been much lower than the number of ethnic Cham because there was it was much closer to areas where ethnic Cham were concentrated.
You've mentioned that
The treatment of targeted groups.
Your Honours, if Council would like to do that, that can happen. It's not going to affect this question of this witness right now. That's his prerogative. We haven't had a chance to speak to this witness to be able to determine whether we're talking about exactly the same person. But Your Honours, has given us a certain amount of time to question the witness. I think the party should be able to use it in the way they think is most beneficial for the task they have. These are all relevant questions. Council can ask those questions in his examination. I'm not saying they're not relevant.
To shorten this, Professor, I don't want you to answer to my question now verbally, but if you know the answer, please take a piece of paper and write the name on it. Do you know who did this? First, I'll answer yes or no for the record.
Do you know who did this? Đăng được cầm đăng tới đồng bài chưa cầm nó tới đó và tại giờ
I know him because I met him.
Đăng bước khi bạn chụp cô.
And now please somebody provide a piece of paper to the professor and if you would write the name down and
we'll
circulate it to the person.
It's not possible for me to do that here now for a couple of reasons. You know, besides the general human subject protocols that I have to follow as part of my research, I don't know his name offhand because as part of your research protocols, you use a pseudonym for people when you refer to them. I can't recall his name. I have that information, you know, in back with my research materials, but I couldn't possibly know for sure if that was his name because I converted his name and began to think. I began to think of him as Tiep, and that was so I, it's not possible for me to provide an answer to that question at this moment in time.
It is an answer for the record.
Wouldn't it be helpful to the chamber if we give the four E3 numbers of WIs that we believe
party in the views?
Of course, we will not have full certainty, but at least you will be able to verify whether our assumptions are right. I'm not saying 100% certainty that this is the same person, but we believe it is. And if we give you the four E3 numbers, then
preferably
I'll try something else. Professor, would you be able, for instance, tomorrow or the day after tomorrow, after you look into your papers, to answer the question I asked?
Yes, thank you, Your Honor. The answer would be, for me to answer a question like that, there would be several different paths. One would be I would need to check with my university about human subjects protocols. The second thing is I don't have my research materials with me here. They're stored away at home, including the code sheet, where there's an elaborate process for him, so there's no possible way for me to do it in the next day or two. The other thing is for me to go try and find him and ask him in person if it's okay for me to reveal his name, but I don't think there's time for that either.
So even if you were shown the name, you couldn't answer for the reasons you just mentioned. I think that clarifies the record to the degree possible. Let's move on.
Thank you, Mr. President, Your Honours. just for the record, perhaps we will move on. Professor, you stated in your book that Tiep also told you, and this is at English 0043-1661 at page 219, that he also told you that during political training sessions and meetings, cadres would, and I quote, always talk about CIA and KGB enemies. Later on, though, they stopped talking as much about the CIA and Lon Nol regime and began speaking about the, quote, arms and legs of the Yuan and, quote, Yuan strings. If a person was ethnic Vietnamese, it was certain that they wouldn't survive. Once they were discovered, that was it. Is that an accurate statement of what Tiep
được là nó cứ chưa chầm lao để tiếp để tiếp bàn phạm luôn mình thế.
Yes, it is.
Chloe, but.
And
did
he elaborate on that point?
Why was a certainty that an ethnic Vietnamese would not survive?
I would have to return to the transcript of the interview. My recollection is because I was interviewing about a number of different topics. Probably we didn't dwell upon this. There was no intent for me to prove genocide against ethnic Cham at that time. I was doing research in general. So this came up during discussions, but I would need to follow up.
So this conversation was a taped conversation with this foreign
worker, correct?
It was taped.
And was it also
transcribed as well? Hay
còn miền ca thực sự chưa bắt tay chưa đặt đài
It was transcribed into Khmer.
But we at the ban ke sase pate charak chi pi sa Khmer hai Khmer nang angle phong dae khnyom cham bai teu pnit
me lang veng sua
ta luk mien ai ka sa pate charak hai nang sai at samlai nu te.
So it's again it's been 20 years. I would have to go back, but I'm virtually certain that I taped it and I would have had it transcribed.
So from your interview
with Teeth and also your study of original documents produced by the CPK, or did he explain what the term arms and legs of the UN or UN strings meant? Did you have any sense from him or from your look at the propaganda of what that meant, what types of people would be included in those two expressions?
Did you have any sense from
I think in this passage he's referring to two things. One are people who are associated with Vietnam, sort of internal enemies born from within, people who are tainted by the association, who then, as the phrase went, Khmer bodies, but Vietnamese, that's sort of an implication, but he also is very directly referring to ethnic Vietnamese as well.
And you also state
on the same page
that several former cadres who worked in Region 41 described how Vietnamese were singled out for execution in the area. Do you see that passage? It's on page 219. So my question is, in addition to Tiep, how many other former cadres in that area talk to you about the singling out of Vietnamese for execution?
Yes, Mr. President, I don't believe that the question is Tiep and other cadres.
Perhaps someone can clarify. So in your book you said Tiep was a former cadre, but to be more specific, what role did he have and whether he was a cadre or had some other role in the Khmer Rouge?
I would need to go back to the original transcripts to know for sure. My recollection is that Khmer would have been referred to colloquially as someone, again, there's sort of the terms that villagers used to describe people, and that people talked about in general, which was a cadre. So my recollection is that this term was used, but I would have to go back and confirm. Again, in terms of this passage, are you referring to several Banyan villagers confirmed that all the Vietnamese living in the villages were killed? Was that the passage you're referring to, or a different one?
The passage I'm referring to is that you mentioned several former cadres who worked in Region 41 described how Vietnamese were singled out for execution in the area. So my question is, in addition to Thiep, who you said worked at the sub-district office, how many other former cadres, or how many former cadres told you about the execution of Vietnamese in that area? Approximately.
I believe, and again, I'd have to check one person who worked at the district office and a couple of people who were village heads. But again, I would need to check my records.
And just on that point, and this is where in your book you say that several Banyan villages confirmed that all of the Vietnamese living in their villages in Region 41 have been killed. Are they the village heads that you just referred to?
So, no, the villagers, again, are from Banyan Village, who were, for the most part, old people, base people. And again, when I went through and did this survey, people talked about the number of families who were killed, and they would mention, again, large numbers of Cham families, because, again, in this district, lots of Cham, but they would also mention if there were ethnic Vietnamese, oh yeah, and there were three ethnic Vietnamese, they took them. But there weren't that many ethnic Vietnamese living in this area, in contrast to the large number of Choms that were residing in this area at the time.
And when you say this area, are you referring to the Banyan village, the Krala commune, or the Kampong Siem district?
You know, they were scattered about because, again, they weren't allowed to return to Banyan Village because it had become the security center. So most of them, many of them, were in Kra La and Osvai. The two where most of them seem to have gone, but they went to all sorts of different districts within Region 41, different communes within Kampong Siem.
And just say briefly in relation to the village heads that spoke to you about the arrest and execution of Vietnamese and the Banyan villages Thiep and the other Khmer Rouge cadre or Khmer Rouge cadre. All of those people together, about how many villages within Kampong Siem district or Krala commune were Vietnamese arrested or executed? Do you have an approximate number from your recollection of different villages?
That's very difficult to remember from 20 years ago without going back and looking. You know, I have from the village, right, there were 500 people, about 100 households living in Banyan Village. Anyway, so I went through there, but I talked to people far and wide, but I'd have to consult records. I wouldn't want to give an official number without checking.
But in total, how many people living in Banyan Village?
How many witnesses did you speak to that you arrested Vietnamese? It's very difficult to remember.
Maybe
as I was going through, talking to the different household heads,
maybe half dozen,
somewhere in there, in the village itself. I can't be sure. Far more mentioned the Johns, but again, it's because there were far fewer ethnic Vietnamese. So if there are no ethnic Vietnamese living in the area, people would not mention it.
Thank you.
And so I would like to put to you an account from another witness. And this witness has given a statement to the ECC investigators. And this witness also worked in the Krala Phong Yen, like Teep, during this period. And this witness was working for the newly arrived Southwest Cadres after May 1977. And this witness states, in answer to the question, and this is at E3/96666, English ERA 0107 2507, and unfortunately the French is not translated.
And the question is,
you said that the previous leaders, this is the question from the investigator, you said that the previous leaders in the commune were arrested upon the arrival of Tha Lang and were replaced by people who came with Tha Lang. Did you witness that? Answer. I saw the people under arrest. I saw them being escorted in a line along the path nearby my house. The heads of the people who were arrested were covered with plastic bags, and their heads were tied, tied behind their backs. They escorted those arrestees during the day. They escorted those people to an undisclosed place. The person who was responsible for the arrest was Hinton, and he was killed in 1979. There was an incident in the village. At that time, there were Cham and Vietnamese families who had managed to hide their ethnic identity until the arrival of Long. Once Long arrived, He ordered the arrest of those Cham and Vietnamese people. Hinh was not a Southwest Zone cadre. He was a chairman of Andong Khao village. But he was a person whom Tha Long trusted. Hinh dared not make the decision to make the arrest himself. The order came from Tha Long. Question. To the best of your knowledge, was it Tha Long alone, or were there any other people who were involved in the decision making for the arrests of those Cham and Vietnamese people? Answer. I do not know it well. I just know that Tha Long was at commune level, while Ye Yit, Ye Yut, was at district level. I did not know how the arrests were coordinated. My question to you is, in your interviews with former cadres and villagers from the Kampong Siem area, were you told that the Vietnamese and Cham living there hid their ethnic identities to avoid being killed, or was that not information that you received?
I don't think it's directly information that I received, but I should note that I think often people would know who the Cham were. Again, if you talk about dress, it didn't seem to be an issue. It seemed to be people would know the Cham. Oh, the Cham lived right next door to me. It seemed to be a clear distinction that was made with regard to the Cham, with regard to ethnic Vietnamese. I don't recall the same sort of distinction. So I guess the answer is no directly to your question, because people wouldn't have had the opportunity to observe in that manner. But I think the construction of difference, looking at the way people dress, speak, so on and so forth, it was self-evident, at least in the case, especially of the Cham.
And the only reason why these portions of statements have been put to you is they are from people that were working in the Kuala commune at the same time, as to see whether it refreshes your memory. The next, well, I would like to quote to you another portion of the same statement, and it's English 01072509. Khmer 00993577. And unfortunately, the French is not it's not translated into French yet.
The question put to this witness is,
you told us earlier that they arrested the Cham and the Vietnamese. Do you know who ordered the arrest? And do you know who took these, where they took these people to? Answer, I do not know who made the decision to arrest the Cham and the Vietnamese, but I know that those people were arrested and taken to be killed at Phnom Cross, Phnom Srey. I learned about this because my mobile unit was later signed to collect ash from the kiln to be used as fertilizer in the rice fields. When we collected the ash to be thrown into the rice fields, we saw the remains of some skulls and hands and legs bones which had not been fully burned. My question to you is, Professor, did you receive any information from those that you interviewed in relation to did you receive any information from the people who spoke to you about where the Cham and Vietnamese were taken, and particularly whether or not Cham and Vietnamese were taken to Phnom Ross, Vietnam, Phnom Srey, execution security center that you talked about yesterday.
So again, I would need to double check the transcripts. Kel is the person who worked there, and I do not believe that he mentioned ethnic Cham and Vietnamese as being brought to Phnom Prok, Phnom Srey. Instead, I think, in the book it's listed that they were new people, different groups that were suspect, class enemies, that were rounded up and taken there. And I believe that the rubber plantation, that the people locally would have been executed at nearby sites, so that a lot of the people were trucking to Wat Phnom Prok, Phnom Srey, were trucking from a little bit further away. And at the time, this area was sealed off, so people couldn't enter into it, though some of the people said they took their cows and witnessed from afar executions taking place. But in the second phase, the head of security, Paul, would take people from the east zone.
Thank you very much.
សម្រាប់ហើយអំពីប្រកាសសម្រាប់ចាប់ពីនេះទៅទៅរហូតដល់ម៉ោង 10 កន្លះសូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្រាប់ការមុនរេរដ្ឋបាលតុលាការរួមរួមផ្ដល់កន្លែងសម្រាប់នៅបន្ទប់រងចាំនិមិត្តសាក់សីដល់សាក់សីជំនាញរូបនេះនៅក្នុងឡងពេលជួបសម្រាប់នឹងអញ្ជើញគាត់មកកាន់កន្លែងផ្ដល់សេចក្ដីកម្មក្នុងបន្ទប់សម្រាប់នាការនេះវិញនៅវេលាម៉ោង 10 កន្លះសម្រាប់ចុះសូមអញ្ជើញក្រុមជើង